grand
merci
discours.
Merci Patrick, un très beau discours.
Leadership in the Total.
My question to you is that
we talk about a lot of electric vehicles today,
sharing,
ride sharing, new technologies, digitization. And I was once in the Saudi Aramco's board meeting discussing about the peak demand of oil is coming much sooner than later. They are very concerned about the future of the oil. And clean energy is required. What is the strategy of Total preparing for the big change or almost revolution of the petroleum civilization is facing? What Total is going to do with this big energy transformation?
Okay. Je réponds en anglais ou en français?
I will answer in English to be polite with.
No?
Or in Japanese?
No, in Japanese it's impossible. Alors, sorry for that. Bon, alors je réponds en. I will answer in English. I think first, Saudi Arabia should not be worried at all. Because if there is one country which will produce the last drop of oil in this planet, it's Saudi Arabia. Why? Because Saudi Arabia has by far the lowest cost oil on this planet. And as I told during my speech, in 2050 you still have oil and gas in the energy mix. The transformation will not be so quick because you have plenty of use of oil, which is not just electric vehicles and passenger vehicles. Today we are absolutely unable to put some batteries, electric batteries, on heavy trucks. By the way, the substitute to oil on trucks would be gas, which is why Total is driving to an oil and gas company. So what is the strategy of Total on oil? In fact, it's fundamentally to try to be as Saudi Arabia, to target only the lowest cost resource. It's why we have decided, for example, to stop any exploration in Arctic areas in oil. It's much too expensive, and it's risky. In fact, that this type of resource, even if we discover oil in Arctic poles, will not be produced because there will be no demand for that. So you know, it was a very famous Saudi oil minister, Shah Yamani, in 2000. He said, the age of stone did not end because of lack of stone, which is true. And he added, and the age of oil will not end because of lack of oil. I perfectly agree with that sentence. It was 17 years ago by a Saudi oil minister, you know. So, I mean, it's a question. So for us, the strategy is let's focus on oil, but low cost. So you have seen Total moving aggressively in many business, in particular in Middle East. Let's also emphasize more on gas, because gas is today the right hydrocarbon. A power plant which is fueled by gas emits twice less CO2 than a power plant which is fueled by coal. So gas is the right transition energy, I would say. It's flexible to go with renewable. So let's increase our gas business, and this is why what we do. And then, last part, let's invest in all these new energies. So we today have, it's small compared to the size of the company, but we have $5 billion of business in low carbon business, in solar, in batteries, in energy efficiency business, and we'll continue to develop it. And we want the company, we have a sort of motto internally that 20% of the company will be in these low carbon, of these new energies in 20 years, maybe earlier. It's just a question to convince our investors that we are right to do that. It takes time sometimes because they love the dividends of Total from oil and gas, you know.
Jean-Claude Meyer.
Jean-Claude Meyer.
Vous n'avez pas dit un mot.
You have not said a word on the nuclear. Can you tell us something about nuclear? What is your scenario concerning this energy capacity.
It happens that I talk about things that I know all the time. When I don't know something very much, I am very cautious. But I know people know much more about nuclear than I do. Nuclear energy is an energy that has all the reasons in the world to develop in the energy mix, world energy mix, especially when we're talking about climate change, because there are no very little pollution, so there is the problem of wastes, of course, but it looks therefore like an ideal solution. The problem is that there was a major accident called Fukushima, and Fukushima in a country which is acknowledged for its science and technology, namely Japan. So this is something that has led to a lot of uncertainties. And many Western countries, like France, who is the world champion in nuclear energy, we have now to put security standards, which are extremely costly and which make of the nuclear energy, the cost of nuclear energy, much higher than that of other energies. So that's one obstacle, one hindrance. Now we can also say that nuclear, probably where it can develop, is India and China. But even in China, and I was struck to see that the Fukushima problem has reduced the speed of the development of nuclear energy. India is not too much into it because of the costs. But again, the safety issues are major issues. So we have to go. We have to be able to have a nuclear power that is more accessible, affordable, so that it can be more competitive. I think that nuclear is a very good solution, especially for the framework of climate change. But I think that now the mindsets are not really ready to invest into the nuclear energy. Third and last question. Let me see who's going to ask the last question. So no more questions. There's one last question. You have given this speech, a very interesting speech, and you gave a figure that I didn't know, that China had become the first important country for petrol, for oil and gas worldwide. Does Total, who distributes refined products throughout the world, does Total make a lot of money in China? Or does Total, or did you yourself notice that probably China does not apply the reciprocity principle and does not really respect its commitments for the exchange, the world trade? So China is a state economy, something that we should stress. And China, we are faced with competition with state companies. There are private, even private companies in China are state companies, so they are very complex competition issues. It happens that we found a segment in which we make some money. We sell a lot of lubricants in China now, but this is one point of entry into the Chinese market. So we see China as being a very good market, but is the turnout sometimes not very interesting for us so far. This is a very complex country, very complex. You can manage to enter into this country, but you have to have partners. You cannot go there just by yourself. So we do business in China now, but it remains quite limited. It's not really an engine for development. What is important, however, for China is that we have made of Chinese partners in Africa, in the Middle East, and we have been going to look at them now, see them and say, let's be partners together. So China is the greatest partner of France, in Iraq, in Russia, and in some African countries. So we prefer to have them as allies rather than have them as competitors. It's better to play judo with them rather than karate, because we will be losers. So before I stop, I would like to say some concluding words. I would like to congratulate Thierry for this 10th edition of this conference, which I think now has become a yearly, very important yearly meeting. Thierry has the capacity to invite a lot of people from all over the world. I was lucky tonight to meet for the first time the First Minister of Albania and the First Minister of Serbia. Only Thierry can manage to bring all these eminent people together. So again, thank you to all of you. Thank you for listening.